In the last class, we're looking at the concept of virtual temperature, which is very important because it lets us use the gas constant of dry air, and we can work out problems with ease. Okay, so it is an important construct or a concept in atmospheric thermodynamics. We will try to work out some problems involving this definition. So, for the sake of completeness, let us quickly go through this. This is virtual temperature given by TV is nothing but the ratio of the actual temperature divided by 1 minus PV dash by P, where epsilon is RD okay. So, it goes without saying that since the denominator is less than 1, TV is always greater than T. Okay. Even in very warm and moist air, is only a few degrees centigrade. All right. Towards the end of the last class, we just saw a very formal definition of virtual temperature. We defined the virtual temperature as the temperature which the gas must be, or atmospheric air must be, raised in order that it has the same density as that of moist air, correct? At the same, say at the same pressure P. All right. So because it is because the gas constant is more for the moist air, so it is less dense and so on. Therefore, it has to be, the dry air has to be heated to a higher temperature so that it matches with this. All right. Let us solve some problems in today's class. Problem number 14. Some students will be entering, it is okay. No? So, problem number 14, if water vapor comprises, please take down the problem, if water vapor comprises 1.5% of the volume of the air, if water vapor comprises 1.5% of the volume of the air, that is, it accounts for 1.5% of the molecules in air. If water vapor comprises 1.5% of the volume of the air, that is, it accounts for 1.5% of the molecules in air, what is the virtual temperature correction? We start solving it. So, when I say the water vapor comprises 1.5% of the volume, then I might as well say that PV dash by P, okay. The ratio of the partial pressure of water vapor to the total is 1.5%. You make it into, remove the percentage, it is 0.015, okay. Now, TV. What is this value? 1.0. Alright. It's 0.5%, right? It's not much, it's all right. Okay. But if you make this correction, you will get better estimates when you work out problems. Is everybody through with this? Marius. Is it okay? I think you should bring calculators to all the classes. Shall we proceed to the next one? Done? Okay. Okay, problem 15. Problem 15, based on the maximum content of water vapor. Problem 15, based on the maximum content of water vapor in the atmosphere given in an earlier table. Based on the maximum content of water vapor in the atmosphere given in an earlier table, what is the virtual temperature of air? Based on the maximum content of water vapor in the atmosphere given in an earlier table, what is the virtual temperature of air when the actual air temperature is 298 Kelvin? Okay. Based on the maximum content of water vapor in the atmosphere given in an earlier table, what is the virtual temperature of air when the actual temperature is 298 Kelvin? It is actually the application of the same formula which we used for problem number 14, except that in this case I am asking you to take the data from a previous table, and in this case instead of giving it as a percentage, I actually gave you the air temperature. So you can actually give the virtual temperature in Kelvin, so that you will know what is the difference between the actual temperature and the TV, the virtual temperature. Please start solving this. First, you should have the data in the previous day.
I hope you are not in the wrong class.
So by the way, the 4:45 class will be in studio 2. So something is going on here. Today we are meeting again at 4:45. All right. Virtual temperature. Okay. What is the maximum content of water vapor? Okay. Very good. So maximum So this is from an earlier table, 5%. Okay, therefore, yes, point, very good. Okay, now. How much is this? Huh? 0.7. Five point. So, the worst case scenario, it doesn't exceed 6 Kelvin. It is not okay. So, I made a statement in an earlier class. In fact, at the beginning of today's class, I made the same statement that the TV minus T is of order of a few degrees centigrade only at the max, at the worst. It is not of the order of tens of degrees centigrade or of the order of hundreds of degrees centigrade. It is a few degrees centigrade. In for 1.5%, it was something like 0.5%. So, if you keep the same 298, that may translate to 1.5 or 2 Kelvin. So, the maximum is 5 Kelvin. But 5 Kelvin is not small enough to be ignored, you have to factor in the calculation. But if it is half or 1 Kelvin up to 1.5, 2 Kelvin, you can, 6 Kelvin may make some changes in your calculation. Is it okay? All right. Now, we will have to get deeper into atmospheric thermodynamics. Is everybody through with this? All right. Okay. So, the answer is this. So, the virtual temperature is 303.74. The temperature correction is 5.7 degrees centigrade. So now we have to start the hydrostatic equation. Consider a reasonably stationary atmosphere. Okay, consider as a slice, consider a horizontal slice of the atmosphere. Okay, the slice is having a height of dz, thickness. Thickness dz. Okay, this is the ground. This is the atmosphere. Okay. Unit horizontal cross sectional area. Let us do a force balance on this. Okay, what is the pressure? The pressure is always acting towards on the surface by convention. So the pressure is P, and the pressure acting from the top is P plus dP. So if you do a force balance, what do you get? That one is cross-sectional area, fine. So because I am g rho dz, we are taking it as positive in the downward direction. So please mark this, correct? The direction of the gravity vector is important. It is always acting downwards, right? Okay. So now if you cancel this out, what do you get? Equation 1. This is a hydrostatic equation, dP by dz equal to, if you consider as a function of several variables, we can also change it to dou P by dou z if you want. Okay, so dP by dz, this is the hydrostatic equation. So what is the relationship between rho and specific volume V? Okay, so if you know the variation of g and if you know the variation of rho with respect to z, the right hand side can be integrated and the left hand side is pretty straightforward, p minus p naught. Okay, or you can start from, you can go all the way up to infinity. When you go all the way up to infinity, what is p of infinity? 0. So you can change the limits and do something. You want to try that? So this is one way of, that is, this is up to some intermediate level, okay. But you want to integrate it all the way up to infinity. it can be integrated between any two limits, right? So P infinity there is a minus, right? You can find the pressure at any height z. It is basically the integral of 0 dz from z to infinity. So the pressure at a particular height is actually the weight of the water column, sorry, weight of the air column above it. All right?
Sir, can we take g constant here?
No, wait, hang on. So we cannot take g constant, and sometimes we can take for if the limits of the integration are you don't otherwise g you have to find out g varies. Okay, we'll work out problems where g varies and all that. Okay. What is a mean sea level pressure? What is that?
180.
From equation 6. Look at equation 6. So P of 0 will be 0 to infinity 0 dz. When that is done and when that is averaged over the globe, that P of 0 has a value equal to 1.013 into 10 to the power of 5 Newton per meter square, which is frequently referred to as 1 atmosphere. Shall we do that? Okay. So this is nothing but 1.013 10 to the power of 5 Newton per meter square. It is also 1.013 10 to the power of 5 Pascal. It is called 1 atmosphere. It is also 1.013 bar. It is 113 millibar. It is also equal to 113 hectopascal.
Sir, that
minus is gone, huh? It is taken care. Very good. So you have some tar, some in childhood you learnt all that, but tar is we pack all the tar and all we don't use. Already there are enough units for pressure. Why struggle with some more? Okay. Please take down this. The P naught. The P naught of the mean sea level pressure is based on the following. The P naught or mean sea level pressure is based on the following. Okay. The mass of P naught or mean sea level pressure is based on the following. The mass of the earth is uniformly distributed over the globe. Sorry. The mass of the earth. With the mass of the atmosphere, right? With the mass of the atmosphere is uniformly distributed over the globe. And the Earth's present topography is retained. Okay? Based on this, you are getting, all right? This is the mean sea level pressure. So the hydrostatic equation is very important. In fact, the hydrostatic equation you also learnt in fluid mechanics, right? Okay, where instead of air, you would have looked at water. mechanical and civil engineering people would have studied, even aero, I think, right? Now, let us go to some further definition, some other definitions. So, we have to look at what is called geopotential. Geopotential is given by phi. So, d phi equal to g d z. But what is the definition of the geopotential itself? Please take down. The geopotential phi at any point in the Earth's atmosphere, the geopotential phi at any point in the Earth's atmosphere is defined as the work that must be done, the geopotential phi at any point in the Earth's atmosphere is defined as the work that must be done against the gravitational field. The work that must be done against the gravitational field of the Earth okay, the geopotential phi or phi is defined in the Earth's atmosphere is defined as the amount of work that must be done against the Earth's gravitational field to raise a body of mass 1 kg. To raise a body of mass 1 kg from sea level to that point. Okay. What is the potential energy if you raise it by some dz? What is the potential energy change? A body of mass m, mg dz. What is the potential energy change for a body of mass 1 kg? What did I write? Okay, fine, that's correct, right? We cannot leave it there, so we will torture it by doing some integrations and limits and all that, right? So we'll have to do that. So d phi is some numbers, please. 8. So this is 1. That 1 is there. So d phi is equal to 0 dz. dp. Therefore, g dz is dp by. So minus is there or it's okay? What is 1 by rho? So you feel the checker, but that is unavoidable. We keep on doing 1 by rho, but it is all same. No, we don't. It's not very difficult concepts, but just to reinforce, I am just putting it in various forms. Okay. 9. Therefore, phi of z. What is phi of z? Okay. There is a sleight of hand here. There is a sleight of hand here. What did I do? Phi of 0? So this is actually phi of z minus phi of 0, but phi of 0 equal to 0, that is simply by convention. That is a datum. Okay, anyway, to raise it by 0 to 0, there is no work done. That answers somebody's question. If g is, if you know the variation of g, just go ahead and you can calculate the, you can go ahead and calculate the phi of z. Okay. Now, it can be verified that phi of z is a point function and it is a property, it is independent of the path. You can raise something from 0 to 45 meters, reduce it to 25 meters, bring it to 84 meters and bring it to finally leave it at 65 meters, and its final phi will be the same as if you take it from 0 to 65 meters. The path doesn't matter at all. It is not like work or heat. Okay? It depends on where it is, on the z at which you are looking at. All right? So, this is a point function. In thermodynamics, we call it as it is a property of the system. Okay? Next is a concept called geopotential height, which is very important. Phi of z by g naught. This is nothing but what is geopotential height z? Please take down the geopotential height z. Is the height to which 1 kg of mass must be raised. Is the height to which 1 kg of mass must be raised. If g equal to 9.81 meters per second squared. Instead of a decreasing g, correct? Okay. So, what is this g naught? Correct, but it is not complete. G naught is a globally averaged acceleration due to gravity at the Earth's surface, which has been assigned a value of 9.81 meters per second squared. Okay, please take down. G naught is the globally averaged acceleration due to gravity at the Earth's surface, and the value of 9.81 meters per second squared is the agreed upon value for G naught. The geopotential height z is a frequently used vertical coordinate in atmospheric science, wherever energy interactions are taking place. Okay? So, the geopotential height z will be frequently seen in plots in the area of in the field of atmospheric science. Now, I will give you a small table. I will give you the value of small z, capital Z and g for various heights. So, you will realize that this 9.81 will slowly increase or decrease with height?
Decrease.
It will decrease with height. Okay. I do not have to say, tell you why. So, some representative place, some measurements have been done and some calculations. Z in kilometer, Z is also in kilometer, G is in meters per second square, 0, 0, 9.81, 1, 10, 100 and 500 kilometers, 1.00, 9.99. 98.47. You can see it starts varying. First two entries are already up to 10 kilometers, then it starts changing. So 9.80, 9.77, 9.50, 8.43. Okay. So, at a height of 500 kilometers, the G can reduce, reduces to value of 8.4 meters per second squared. So, if you are doing calculations involving hundreds of kilometers of atmosphere, a value of 9.81 is not correct. If your attention is restricted only to the troposphere, then it does not make much difference, right? It is still 9.81 to 9.8, you can use that. So, what is your consideration you have to see? We are looking at jet weather events, and first 10 kilometers you can just take, you can pack all this, you can just take it as G naught. Alright. Now, Z2 minus Z1 is something which we have to obtain now. So, we will have to do some derivation, go through some mathematical steps. Let us do that now. Is it clear up to this stage? You can see that so differences begin after some height. So, let us work with dou p by dou z. Rho inconvenient to use. Please give some equation number to this. Okay. And rho is hardly measured. So the challenge in atmospheric science is to get rid of the rho. We are so fond of rho in chemistry, but we have to get rid of the rho in atmospheric science. Okay. So please help me. How will you remove the rho? Ideal gas equation. Okay, we'll remove the rho through the ideal gas equation. P by which R and which T? R? D. And T is? Very good. So, just now the last class we have seen the concept of virtual temperature. So, it should be P is the same. P is the same, but R is basic, because moist air, there can be RV is different from RD. So, if it both D and V are there, dry air is, there is moist air, then water vapor is present, then we do not know which one to use. So, that is why we discussed, we articulated the concept of the virtual temperature, and so we use RD and TV. Is it okay? So, now please start working on this. I want to get Z2 minus Z1. Okay. What is GDZ? Is also equal to okay. So equation 13. Okay. I'll call this equation 14. All right. So sorry? No. Right, I am thinking about something else. So now dP by dz is 0. Okay? Just simplify this. What will be the next step? GdZ is d5. Okay. So this is rd minus. Or you can take dp by p. Is that okay? That's fine. 15. Now, is it okay? So 5-2 minus 5-1. Minus is the minus there? Yes. I will answer your question, just hang on. Okay, we will complete this. RD what will happen to the TV? There is some G, no? No, fine. RT you wanted to keep the TV inside, right? We will keep it, no problem. See, TV is having that PV dash and P. So, it is dangerous to, that answers your question, right? But that PV dash by P is a small quantity. So, you have to take a call on whether you have to retain it or not. Okay. So, is this correct? Did I miss this minus? I have missed, okay. All right. Then Z2 minus Z1, that is a goal, right? What is that? I am integrating only left side, right side. Why are you complicating things? It's fine. No? What is the mistake in this? You tell me. You want to find out that Z. That's why whatever you are putting all the other things on the right hand side. There is no problem. Okay. So, Z2 minus Z1 okay. So this is an important relation. So Z2 minus Z1 is the geopotential thickness between two levels P1 and P2. If there are two pressure levels, P1 and P2 in the atmosphere. Z2 minus Z1 is the geopotential thickness between two pressure levels. For an isothermal atmosphere, if you consider that the TV and T are sufficiently close to each other, that is, it is not 5% water vapor, it is just 1 or 2% water vapor, then it is possible for you to pull out the TV out of the integral, in which case the TV can be replaced by T, then you will have Z2 minus Z1 equal to RD into T by G naught into dP by this thing, okay. That R into T by G, that R into T by G is very interesting. I will just explain that concept and stop, we will continue in the afternoon. So, if you make it as, if it is an isothermal atmosphere, the temperature is not changing, and we can take this out of the integral, and then I say that TV and T are very close to each other, then I make it RD T by G. What will be the units of RD? Joules. This is, what is kilogram meter per second square? Joules. Is it correct? Is it non-dimensional? Okay, so this is kilogram is Newton, right? So you are getting okay, it is non-dimensional. Now, is it okay? No. Hurry, just hang on. Kilogram meter per second square is what? Okay, let's do this. I think I messed this up here. So it will have finally meter. That is actually H, the scale height of the atmosphere, which we use as 7.5 kilometers in one of the earlier problems. So this RD T by G naught is very interesting, 287 by 9.8 into T. This will actually turn out to be, we will do it in the next class, 29.3 T. And between the stratosphere, if you take the average of troposphere and stratosphere, T will be 255 Kelvin. So if you multiply 255 by 30, you will get something like 7500 meters, and 7.5 kilometers is the scale height of the atmosphere. Then if you have the scale height of the atmosphere, you will get a very beautiful relationship that P by P naught is e to the power of minus z by h. That is the equation which we started out in the earlier classes, but now we have formally derived it from first principles, starting from the hydrostatic equation, definition of geopotential, definition of geopotential thickness, introduction of virtual temperature, and making a correction for the virtual temperature, and then introducing this concept of scale height.